one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is. The didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name. Wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name.
Yours is the glory.
Yours is the name.
Friends of St. Peter's, and thank you so much for joining us this morning. We're so glad to have you with us on this very special Sunday, which is not only Beach Hat Sunday, because, you know, Flip-Flop Sunday just doesn't have the same meaning that it used to, but also our Pop and Praise Music Sunday. So we have delightful music for you this morning, as well as a bit of a sense of fun. We're also so grateful to have Caroline and Mirabel Hunt, as well as Philip Gooding with us as our lectors. This is their first time with us lecturing in this context, and we're grateful for them taking on this new reality. So thank you for being with us. Reverend Martha is our preacher this weekend, and we're grateful to her as well. And Deacon Bob will be proclaiming the gospel as well as sending us back out into the world to serve in Christ's name. Our opening hymn this morning, which you'll find in your bulletin if you just click on that link, whether you're on YouTube or Facebook, is All Who Hunger, Gather Gladly. And we'll begin singing after the opening bell. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Also with you.
Let us pray. Let your continual mercy, O Lord, cleanse and defend your church. And because it cannot continue in safety without your help, protect and govern it always by your goodness. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of Genesis. The same night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hear my plea of innocence, O Lord. Give heed to my cry. Listen to my prayer, which does not come from lying lips.
Let my vindication come forth from your presence. Let your eyes be fixed on justice.
Weigh my heart. Summon me by night. Melt me down. You will find no impurity in me.
I give no offense with my mouth as others do. I have heeded the words of your lips.
My footsteps hold fast to the ways of your law. In your paths my feet shall not stumble.
I call upon you, O God, for you will answer me. Incline your ear to me and hear my words.
Show me your marvelous loving kindness, O Savior of those who take refuge at your right hand from those who will rise up against them.
But at my vindication I shall see your face. When I awake, I shall be satisfied, beholding your likeness. A reading from Paul's letter to the church in Rome. I am speaking the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it by the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart, for I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my own people, my kindred according to the flesh. They are Israelites, and to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. To them belong the patriarchs, and from them, according to the flesh, comes the Messiah, who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
As we gather, listen to
of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus withdrew in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You, give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here but five loaves and two fish." And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the five loaves and the two fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds. and all ate and were filled, and they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
And all ate and were filled, and they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. There is a term used in archaeology called ground truthing. It's a process by which archaeologists confirm or validate theories by direct observation on the ground, rather than by interpretation or remotely obtained data. They start a dig and work their way through layer after layer, stratum after stratum, to ground truth in order to get to the true story, the true history of the site they're excavating. Well, today we're going to ground truth the story of Jesus and his disciples feeding the 5,000 men, and of course, plus women and children. A lot of people were fed that day. And you may recall that last week our gospel reading was a series of the kingdom of heaven is like. The kingdom of heaven is like a pearl of great price, like treasure buried in a field, like a fishing net, etc. And our lectionary picks up today with the feeding story, but it skips the gospel text in Matthew between last weekend's sort of multiple types of or similes, really, and this weekend's reading. And it's a very significant omission. Because if we're ground truthing today's gospel, we need to know what happened in between. We need to know that layer that was left out in order to understand the full story and the full impact of the layer that we're actually in today. The missing layer is the killing of John the Baptist at the palace of Herod, and the delivery of his head on a platter at Herod's birthday party. This is not an insignificant omission for today's gospel reading. One way that people in ancient societies showed wealth was through banquets. Images of banquets are everywhere in the Bible, both as historical events and hopeful eschatological end of time gatherings of abundance. If you think about, for example, our burial rite, our burial liturgy, we read scriptures about the heavenly banquet, that place of great celebration and victory over all of the types of poverty that we can experience as humans. The banquet is a very powerful image of inclusion and exclusion. And this explains why so many of the scenes in Jesus' life, the parables he tells, and so on, feature banquets. Who held them, who was invited, who was excluded, who sat where. Every aspect of these feasts was planned and worked to stratify those in attendance. You knew, based on where you sat at a banquet, where you stood in societal order based on that location. So in our ground truthing for today, Herod has thrown a birthday party, which is a very great show of power indeed. And this is Herod Antipas, one of the three sons of Herod the Great. The location of this banquet is believed by scholars to be at a palace high on a rock promontory on the east side of the Dead Sea that overlooks Jordan really to the east, which was a great location for Herod because he could see any threats coming from the east, from that location. Well, John had called Herod out on Herod's improper divorce and marriage to then his brother's wife. So John is now imprisoned. The crowds are not happy with Herod because they believe that John is a prophet. They believe John is a godly man, is a holy man, and they agree with him. And Herod is afraid. So during the party, the request is made, really from his wife, but to the wife's daughter, to have John killed and his head delivered on a platter, so that John, who had criticized that marriage would be silenced. And we're told why Herod does this. Matthew's gospel reads, "The king was grieved, yet out of regard for his oaths and for the guests, he commanded it to be given." So he did this so he wouldn't lose face in front of the company at his birthday party. He did not want to lose face in front of his guests. So we meet up with Jesus in today's gospel story when he's just heard this news of John's death. The death of this man who became less so that he, Jesus, could become more. He is in a moment of what must have been similar to the moment that comes later in Jesus's life when he's in the Garden of Gethsemane, when all of his disciples have abandoned him, a moment of God's revelation to him, of God's very self, God's mission, God's breaking through in Christ, through the falsity, through the emptiness of human-built empires. There's no going back for Jesus. If he steps away from being the more, he renders John's life, John's martyrdom, worthless. He will have squandered his cousin's very purpose, his very life, rather than having honored it and justified it. So it's at this moment, while in solitude and perhaps in the depths of his own sorrow, that Jesus is then called to feed the hungry. He's called to draw from the deep reservoirs at that moment, which must have felt pretty empty, I would think. He's called in that moment to call on himself in order to give more of himself, to be the more, to be the bread, to be the way and the truth and the life. And Jesus's banquet is nothing like Herod's, is it? It's at sea level to begin with. Everyone's invited. No one is turned away. This banquet is a banquet of life, and not just barely subsisting life, not just getting by, not just survival. A life of abundance, of overflowing goodness and nourishment. All were satisfied. All were filled. There were 12 baskets of leftovers. A basket for each disciple who served. A basket for each of the 12 tribes of Israel. Baskets of promise that the banquet will continue to exist. It will not end. It's a bit painful to consider this story now because of its Eucharistic overtones, the taking, the blessing, the breaking, the sharing of bread of Jesus in this scene isn't possible for us today. COVID-19 has placed us in this sudden deprivation of touching and smelling and tasting the bread and wine of Holy Eucharist. Our worship experiences are limited to hearing and seeing, which we do, you know, they don't really feel fully incarnational to us when we're so used to being able to incarnate all of the dimensions of Eucharist. And yet, Jesus and the disciples fed thousands from very, very little, from fragments, really. In the most fundamental way, this beautiful story of the feeding is a continuation of the creation story itself. Just as in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, so Jesus continued to create life where it did not exist before. Life after the death of his cousin John, life out of fragments. And we're in a place of creating new life too. Out of remnants, out of shards, out of fragments of our pre-COVID lives. Parts of our lives still work as they did before, but many do not. How can we keep singing the Lord's song in this unfamiliar land? How do we do that? Well, we trust, we know, there is no doubt that this time will end. there will come a time when we look back and say, remember when during COVID that someone left a rock in front of my house and all the houses on the street? Remember during COVID when we saw families playing, shooting hoops before parents would have ordinarily been home from work? Remember when? We keep singing the Lord's song by memorializing now that which we hope to remember in the future, because the future is coming. I heard a dramatic example of this the other day. A young man, just 20 years old, was told that he was going to lose all of his hearing sometime in the next 6 months due to a rare condition. This is true. He had to decide what music he would want to carry with him into a world of silence when he could no longer hear the music that shaped his life. He was determined to remember music that brought him joy rather than sorrow. So he compiled a soundtrack of his life as a gift to himself for the future. And the ground truth of today's gospel is for us to identify the gifts that we are experiencing now, so we don't lose them when the time comes for us to no longer be isolated. What are the gifts of this time? What matters? How much is enough? Where do you find joy? Where are you finding unexpected blessings? Let's fill baskets with goodness and gifts and wisdom right now, knowing we will cherish them in the future, knowing that with faith and hope and love and God's abundance, we know that Jesus is with us every step of the way. And just as we sang this morning as our opening hymn, taste and see the grace eternal. Taste and see that God is good. Amen.
Let us recite together the Nicene Creed, foundation of our Christian faith.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
As we prepare for the prayers of the people, just a reminder that if you're celebrating a birthday or an anniversary this week, to let us know in the comments, both on YouTube and on Facebook.
Journey to the waters of God's refreshing kindness, offering our prayers and responding.
Hear us, good Lord.
that we may be prepared for the struggles of life, knowing that through suffering we receive grace, and that in the midst of trials, Jesus is forming us in love. Let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
That we may be satisfied beholding the likeness of others, seeing in them the face of Christ, especially those who are poor and hardworking, homeless and destitute, imprisoned and alone, orphaned and afraid, grieving and lost. Let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
That we may take responsibility for sharing our ideas and lending our support to those who lead the church, government, and public institutions, that we may share in the building of the social and spiritual fabric of our society. Let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
That we may trust the transforming power of Jesus to take even our meager offerings and create the resources that reveal the promises of the kingdom. Let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
That we may honor the writers of the Gospels and Epistles whose unique contributions form our sacred texts, and those in our own day who bring the light of God through books, articles, websites, and blogs. Let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
That light perpetual may shine upon the faithful, faithful departed, as they come into their true home in the unending joy of the saints. Let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
O most mighty and merciful God, in this time of great sickness, we flee to you for relief and comfort. Deliver us, we beseech you, from our peril. Give strength and skill to all those who minister to the sick. Prosper the means made use for their cure. Comfort those who mourn or who are in great financial distress. Endue our leaders with wisdom and courage. And grant that, perceiving how frail and uncertain our life is, we may apply our hearts to that heavenly wisdom which leads to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Amen. And the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Please share with one another the signs of God's peace. Know we share that peace with you. And we do come now to our birthday and anniversary prayer. And we celebrate the birthdays this week of Valerie Chereskin, Alan Chapman, and Jeff Riggs. And whoever else you've shared with us in the comments. And we lift them all up together as we pray. Watch over thy servants, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts, may thy peace, which passeth understanding, abide all the days of their lives through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And as we come to our offertory, as ever, we thank you. We thank you for your incredible generosity during this time. your support for the mission and ministry of God in Christ's name through St. Peter's in the various ways that we find ourselves being church at this time. And your support makes that possible. You're welcome to give by text to give at 858-252-0622. Or you're also welcome to give online at stpetersdelmar.net/give. You can also give through the postal service at P.O. Box 336, Del Mar, California, 92014. Walk in love as Christ loves us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to God.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Thank you. sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. Worship your holy name. Worship your
now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And let us pray the general thanksgiving together. God, our creator, our center, our friend, we thank you for our good life, for those who are dear to us, for our dead, and for all who have helped and influenced us. We thank you for the measure of freedom we have and the extent to which we control our lives. And most of all, we thank you for the faith that is in us, for our awareness of you, and our hope in you. Keep us, we pray you, thankful and hopeful and useful until our lives shall end. Amen. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you on this day and always. Amen. We do have a few announcements today. A reminder that our book study of Return of the Prodigal Son by Henri Nouwen continues at 10 o'clock on Sundays by Zoom. So I hope that you'll join us for that, even if you haven't already. And thanks again to our musicians for this Pop and Praise Sunday. And a reminder to put on my beach hat. Beach hats for announcements. Also, a reminder that next Sunday is our Jazz Music Sunday. And so that promises to be a great deal of fun. We hope that you'll join us for Jazz Music Sunday. Tell your friends to join us as well. Are there any other announcements that I should be making that I've forgotten? Nope. Deacon Bob, will you dismiss us? Oh, no, we've got a song. It's time for a song. That's right, because how could I forget this wonderful song by Doris Akers? Lead me, guide me, then Deacon Bob can dismiss us.
Thank you.
Go into the world in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.